We are here in northwest Wales, and this is a place called Maes, Artro. It is incredibly haunted, and this is the third and final night here. We've had two incredible nights. This is Most Haunted Live.
Good evening, welcome to Wales. This is the third night of Most Haunted Live. I'm David Bull. We're coming to you live from Clambedda in northwest Wales. Surrounding this studio are a nest of World War II buildings which are showing their true colours as some of the most paranormally significant locations we have ever visited. Now, if you watched last night, you will know that we just about survived everything that the elements could throw at us. We endured a gale, torrential rain, and our studio here became so unstable that we had to evacuate the audience and the whole crew into another building. Now, if you were into conspiracy theories, you might think that someone or something was out to get us. But we stayed with it, and over the evening we witnessed some of the most extraordinary paranormal phenomena we have ever seen. And it seems the paranormal activity is not just confined to these buildings, because last night we also found that there is good reason to believe that the whole coastline is a hotbed of paranormal occurrences. But what will happen tonight? Let's see what we've got coming up.
Welcome to Maes Artro, the haunted living quarters of an active World War II air base. Tonight, on the last night of our Northwest Wales paranormal investigation, we're going to be breaking open the mysterious secret chamber, looking into instances of reported on-site table tipping, finding psychic revelations from the shipwrecked coast of Shell Island, asking the country to help with remote viewing, and visiting the most paranormally active location on the whole site. All this tonight on Most Haunted Live.
Well, it's going to be a great night. Now, to help us understand what we're likely to see this evening, we have a dazzling array of experts with us, as always. So behind me on the sofa is our skeptic parapsychologist and academic Louis Sava, within medium David Wells. Good evening to both of you. The books and the desks. It's our historical experts, Richard James and Richard Felix. Hello to you. And with his gaggle of gorgeous girls and guys holding our interactive team together, it's the man, it's Julian Clegg. And last, but by no means least, please will you welcome our frontline paranormal investigators. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together because it's Yvette Fielding, Derek Okora and Kieran O'Keefe. Last night was an amazing night. I mean, not only did the studio collapse, we evacuated this particular area. For you, though, Yvette, what was it like?
It was absolutely amazing. I couldn't quite believe that so much happened in such a short space of time. I mean, it really did, didn't it?
Yes,
it was amazing. Yeah. It was great.
And you've done so many investigations now. I know that last night had particular significance for you anyway, but you were really impressed by what we found?
Yeah, particularly for me, it was in the 1940s house. It really did astound me, and I know it did with everybody else.
Oh, we'll talk
too
about that in just a minute. But, Derek, last night you came up with these names, James and Jeffrey. You came up with lots of other pieces of information which were corroborated by the historians.
Were they?
Yeah, a good night for you, I would have said.
Well, I was just pink and tingling because something happened last evening that's never happened before, and it's the spirit people here were so willing to make this connection. and I'm way excited. I can't wait for tonight.
Oh, well, I can't honestly, either, actually. And Kieran, we used some new equipment last night, didn't we? We used thermal imaging. I know that you try and be as objective as you can. How important was that for you last night?
I think the thermal imager, it was a first, basically, on a ghost investigation. I know there's going to be a lot of groups out there very jealous that I was the first person to use it. It's great for objective measures. Absolutely fantastic. And I think we're going to use it again tonight to great effect.
Fantastic. I can't wait, though. And last night, as I was saying, it was an amazing night. So let's have a look at some of last night's highlights.
God, Johansson, I'm getting that strong now. Johansson.
Johansson, if you can hear my voice. Yes. Look at the flag.
Flight. Flight, did you hear that? Yeah, that's okay. Don't be worried.
Right.
Did you hear me? Oh, my face. Whoa. Take it off. Take it off. Take it off. Please, 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 please. Take it off.
And would you be able to pick up? Are you all right?
Yes, yes, okay. I do. I fly many planes.
What's your favourite?
Oh, the Spitfire.
Jeffrey.
Is that you? I'm burning.
Did someone just go?
The German prisoners of war here. In groups.
So cold.
Lonely, yeah, cold, lonely.
Whoa, did you hear that?
Yes.
Did you hear it?
Yeah. Did you hear that moan?
Yes.
Amazing, really, really amazing. Now, one thing that has really, really stuck in my mind from last night was you, bizarrely, Yvette, because you were so convinced you heard someone laugh.
Yeah, you actually picked it up there. There's a part in the 1940s room. Derek actually says the word flight, and just after that word, I heard it. It was so clear to me, and it was a real laugh. Now, nobody else in the crew laughed. And it was it was so clear to me. And Tom, our sound recordist, heard it. Kath, who was in the other room, heard it as well. So quite a few of us heard it. And it scared me to death because I wasn't expecting it. And it was a laugh.
You could tell how frightened you were, actually.
Oh, yeah.
But what I'd like to do now is actually look at that clip once again when you think you heard that laugh.
And it's after the word, when Derek says flight. So see if you can hear it at home as well.
Okay.
Flight. Blight, did you hear that? Did you hear that? It's okay, don't be worried.
Right.
Did you hear?
What did you hear?
Did anybody...
I heard this, like, laughing.
Oh, my God!
Skitting laugh.
Sorry. I can't believe we're going to go back in there and do it all over again.
But it was extraordinary because, you know, throughout all the investigations, I know that you've become quite resilient to a lot of it, but you were so, so sure of what you heard last night.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And I think, I mean, I keep saying to Kieran, you know, is it your imagination? You start to wonder. But in fact, you know, I've heard so many things now. And it's not convincing me, but it's certainly scaring me to death.
Okay, well, the question is, where are you going to start tonight?
We are actually going to start, it's a variety, it's a lovely place,
okay.
And we're going to go into a very haunted location that many people have seen, felt a variety of things, so we're really excited about
where is that?
There. It's basically, I've forgotten!
Okay, well, where? You've forgotten where you're going?
I've forgotten!
Shall I tell you where we're going to send you?
Please, yes, I'm really nervous.
We're going to send the team. The reason that she is very nervous is because we're going to send you somewhere not particularly nice. We're going to send you and the rest of the team to the air raid
That's
shelter.
That's right, yes. Oh,
okay?
God, yes.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and give them a lot of luck as they go. Ladies and gentlemen, our investigative team, please go to your first location. I don't blame her being scared, actually. Now, the last two nights have been an incredible journey. Over 2 million of you have joined us so far, making this officially the largest live ghost hunt in the world, and I think that deserves a round of applause. So give yourselves a round of applause for that. Now, also, I do want to say a very big thank you to all of you at home, wherever you're watching in the United Kingdom. I also know we have viewers abroad as well. Thank you also for all your texts, your comments, and so on. And the psychic art as well has been amazingly revealing, I feel. Now, this is from Wendy in Oldham. She says she's seen this particular face in the background 3 times. She says this face is really, really scary. So I'll show you that to you now. Have a look. Now, who could that be? Oh, there he is, look!
Thank you, David. I love it. good evening. Now, so far on this investigation, we've had a record number of sightings, 22 million hits on the website. To put that in perspective, over three nights in Derby, it was 15 million hits, so it's quite extraordinary. Also, 28,000 ghostly sightings reported on the website and on text. Now, one of the impressive themes of last night's show was the number of people seeing the same thing at the same time on our webcams. In the morgue, for example, numerous viewers reported a stationary figure standing in the middle of the room, staring straight at the camera, a man kneeling down in the corner, and flashes moving up and down the wall. That was last night. You've also been giving us your views on our EVP files. We've had 1,200 responses on those, and more on that later, but for track one, hundreds of people reported hearing a voice saying no. Track two seemed to contain the sound of marching or rifles being loaded. And on track three, moaning and groaning. And track four, whistling. We've got two new EVP files for you later on in the programme. Now, we need you to be our eyes and ears on this show. And once again, we want you to get in touch. And this is how you do it. First of all, you can get to us through our website at livingtv.co.uk/mosthauntedlive. You can text us on 83088. And put haunted, MSG for message, then a space, then your message, or fax us and send us your psychic art, like that lovely one of me there. 01341 241 771, and we'll be putting those numbers up throughout the programme, so if you didn't get them down, don't worry, you'll see them coming up. And tonight's webcams are all up and running, and let me tell you about them first. First of all, two in the very scary air raid shelter where Yvette is going, so let's have a look at those right now. That's camera one and two, and then we have two in the officer's mess. And this is interesting, this is where we're going to be having our big experiment tonight, the time slip. And one of those, camera four, as you can see there, is the thermal imaging camera, so you can compare and contrast three and four. Now, whilst we have a moment, let's talk about tonight's competition. And this is great, it's to win tickets to come to our Halloween Most Haunted Live. And that will be, as the tradition dictates, at the end of October. And all you have to do is answer this simple question. Our last Most Haunted Live investigation took place in the dead centre of England. Where was it? Was it A, Derby, B, Cornwall, or C, York? Now, if you're a digital satellite viewer, press the red button now or any time through the programme to enter. Also, you can text, so get to your mobile phone and go to this number, 80088. Then put in the word haunted comp, followed by a space, followed by your answer, A, B, or C. So it's going to be a busy night. Go to the website, livingtv.co.uk/mosthauntedlive. And David, we'll see you a little bit later on the programme.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Julian. I really wouldn't worry about the photo, the picture, though, because imitation is the greatest form of flattery.
Indeed.
Now, during the excitement of the last few days, you helped us to find a hidden chamber in the east quadrant of this site. Now, what we have done, we've started its excavation. And Yvette is there with a quick update. So let's go now and find out how it's going. Yvette.
Hi, thanks, David. No, sorry, before I go to the air raid shelter, I just thought I'd come and check out the hidden chamber. Now, this is Dave. Now, Dave, you've been digging for a while now. How's it been going?
Well, it's going fine. We've been at it for about 4 hours, I guess, now. It's some kind of structure down there, but we're not quite sure exactly what it is. But during the course of the evening, we'll let you know exactly what we find. Okay. By the end of the evening, I'm sure we'll be able to tell you what it is.
How far have you got so far?
We're down about 4.5 foot okay. at the moment.
We'll leave you to it and we'll come back later on. Okay, fine. David, they're doing really well. Back to you.
Lovely. Thank you very much. Indeed, Yvette. So it's fantastic stuff. And don't forget that you at home were the people that actually said, this is where you believe the chamber to be. And so we have excavated exactly where you told us to dig. But what will it reveal? We'll find out in a few minutes after this break. Welcome back. back to Most Haunted Live on our third night of our investigation into North West Wales. Now, Yvette is on the way to the air raid shelter, as I said earlier on, but she's stopping off on the way at the officers' mess. Now, that's right in the middle of the site. And the reason for that is because she is going to set up an experiment. Let's have a look at where she is going, OK? Now, the officers' mess, you will see now as we show you this map, is just to give you an idea of the location. And as we zoom in, you can see that the officers' mess is situated right there. Now, most of the phenomena reported in this location takes place during 1940s revival nights, which are held fairly regularly by the museum. And that is exactly what we're going to do tonight. We're going to recreate that tonight. So let's go and find out how we're going to do that. Yvette.
Thanks, David. Well, here we are in the officers' mess. And as you can see behind me, we've got some lovely, very young ladies and gentlemen who are dressed up in all the 1940s World War II gear. And hopefully, when the music starts, we're going to start dancing, as they did here in the 1940s. Paranormal activity will occur because that is what happens when they hold the 1940s nights here. People have been pushed, prodded, they've seen things, seen shadows. The lights will often short out and doors will bang on their own. So it's going to be very exciting. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to dim the lights. We're going to get the music going. The guys are going to start dancing and hopefully start to feel the right mood. And hopefully something will happen, David.
Indeed, Yvette. Well, I'm now with Shirley Green. She runs those 1940s nights. So tell me, Shirley, what kind of phenomena have happened when you've held these 1940s nights?
Well, it's been quite interesting, really, because several people on the first 40s night that we had all complained of being prodded in the back, or as they were dancing around the dance floor, they had actually felt people brush past them, or, as I say, actually feel somebody prodding them in the back.
And had these people been drinking?
Yes, of course, they've been drinking.
Right, but they're pretty sure that there was something that they couldn't attribute to something there.
Yeah, because some of them, you know, it had sort of, you know, put them on edge. And I myself have felt that. I've often sat at the bar, at the end of the bar, and actually felt someone go past me, felt sudden gusts of cold air come right past me for no reason at all.
And how often are these sort of things happening?
Very often. I mean, they do happen on revival evenings when everybody's in 40s costumes, but it does happen quite frequently when we're just in there on our own, or, you know, you'll pop into the function room to pick something up and you'll very often feel that there's somebody there, or you'll hear something.
But you're convinced that it's the 1940s, the recreation of the 1940s, that makes this happen?
I do feel that since we've been here and revived the 1940s, yes, definitely.
Okay, well, let's see what happens tonight. Let's go back now to Yvette.
OK, we're going to start the experiment. Just to let you know, we've got Brian Shepherd here. Now, you're going to sit in the corner and see if anything happens, comes to you, and you're going to start drawing it, because you're a psychic artist.
Yep, I'll do that.
OK, brilliant. If you want to go and get yourself sorted.
Thank you.
OK, Kieran, are you happy with everything?
Yeah, I'm very happy. We've got cameras also locked off at various points around. We've got the thermal imager up in the corner. I've also got a hygrometer and, like, backing up any temperature anomalies that we get as well.
OK.
Very happy.
All right, so if we want to, first of all, if we want to sort of get the music going, and then, of course, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to sort of start dancing, and please report to anybody if you feel cold spots, prodding in your back, anything at all. If you see anything, please report to a member of our staff here. So off you go. Okay. And what we're going to do now is we're going to dim the lights. We're going to dim the lights and we're going to switch to night vision camera. Okay, so the experiment has now begun. So not only they're dancing around in the dark, hopefully something is going to happen. We're going to monitor this experiment for quite a long period during the programme, and hopefully something's going to happen. And we're going to pick something up, I'm sure, on the thermal imaging camera if people feel cold spots, which is going to be very exciting. Yeah. So good luck to all of you. Keep dancing.
Since you, just before you finished speaking, I got a tap on my left shoulder.
You did?
I turned and I've seen a man. He looks like an officer.
Really?
And I just asked him to, and he said something to me. And there's two of them coming. There's two of them here right now.
Okay.
Wow.
Right.
Two of them.
It'll be interesting to see if they actually start to sort of mix and mingle and maybe make their presence felt with the people here tonight.
Yes.
Okay, can you describe what these officers look like?
Yes, the first one was a slim looking man, about 5 foot eight, very drawn looking features, the face, but a very, jokey sort of a man, you know, full of laughter, nothing angry about him. Absolutely thrilled this is happening, I feel. And he's a wing commander. Thank you, Sam. Wing commander.
So we've got two ghosts of officers in this room with our people tonight. This is great. Julian, this is really exciting for us. We've got activity happening here, according to Derek.
Yvette, thank you very much for that. And what's really fascinating about this whole experiment is you can monitor the goings-on in the time slip experiment on the webcams. And, of course, we've got that imaging camera there as well, which makes it really interesting to compare the two. So go to livingtv.co.uk/mosthauntedlive and look at the cameras, which are locked off there. And we've had some stories already incoming coming in about this. Thomas Storm's father was stationed up here, and when his mother went to a dance on the site, a whole wall of wallpaper fell off the wall, as if someone had pulled it down, which is an extraordinary story. So keep those coming, please. Now, you also need to go to the website tonight for our experiment and for our vote, which we're going to run, because we need you to tell us where you think the most paranormally significant place is on the site that we've been over the last three nights. So go to livingtv.co.uk/mosthaunted, and let's look at the map. And what will happen is when you go to the website, you'll see the map, here it is. Click your mouse somewhere on the site which you think is the most paranormally significant. It may be somewhere we've been already, or maybe somewhere new. And to make this really work, we need as many people as possible to do this. Then statistically, we've got a bigger sample size, so please go to the website, do that, and then later on in the program we'll decide where the vigil is going to be later on in the program, all importantly. Now, David, over to you.
Thank you very much indeed, Julian. David Wells, just looking at the 1940s experiment, how do you feel this is going to go? Is this something that's valid in your books?
Well, yes, it is. What you're doing is you're encouraging the right situations. You're recreating the right mood, I guess, for them to want to be attracted. You know, they're going to see us initially as light. You know, spirit sees us as light. And when you're doing something like this, they're naturally attracted to it.
Okay. What do you make of this, Louis?
Well, I'm, again, very excited that we're using the thermal imaging cameras. So, you know, if people are experiencing cold spots, we might be able to find objective evidence to back up what they're experiencing. So I'm very excited by it.
All right, lovely. Well, we shall see, shan't we, throughout the course of this evening. Well, Yvette and the team have just about arrived at the air raid shelter, but what can they expect? Well, here we are. This is where they're off to. They're going off to the air raid shelter, which will give you a very good idea. There's the location. There it is, the air raid shelter. Now, this is a whole series of buildings here, actually, around this particular location. So you can see exactly how that fits into the map. So what will they expect there, given what we've seen over the last two nights? Well, here is the story behind our next location.
Down in the claustrophobic air raid shelter, three paranormal events take place on a regular basis. Firstly, a tall, dark, ghostly shape often appears. Secondly, a trigger object that's set down here will always move. And lastly, the sound of squeaky boots will often be heard. Oh, God.
Okay, yeah.
I hate it in here so much. Yeah. I'm so glad that John and Carl and everybody's down here at the bottom.
Yeah.
I just don't like it at all in this air raid shelter. It makes me so nervous every time I've been in here today.
Yeah.
Especially down this end, I don't know what it is, it scares me to death.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know whether it's because it's enclosed here and because it's so dark. I hate it.
It's very impressive, isn't it? It's very claustrophobic.
Yes.
Okay, do you pick up on anything in here, Derek?
Well, just a moment ago, it was like as if I was getting a replay. This is definitely coming from the residual energy. And I heard two male voices, and it seems as if they were in discussion here. They must have been here at some time and discussing something. They've just come back. They can't believe it. They're down here, and they've just come back after a successful sortie.
Do you think, sorry, Derry, that they would have come back in here today at some point?
Most definitely I do, yes.
Because the reason why I asked that is that Kieran had set up a trigger object, didn't you?
Yeah, I've got
today.
Four objects there.
And then just before we came in,
yeah,
the objects had actually moved. Yeah. Now, you can't say...
Yeah, I double-checked them, and they certainly had moved, but because we do have crew in there and in here, I obviously can't say that it is paranormal.
But what we have got is, of course, the webcam has been running all day, and I'm just wondering if anybody at home has actually seen anything or witnessed anything, maybe actually seeing some of the trigger objects being moved. Please get in touch with us, because it's really important. So that it would be amazing if somebody does ring in
and get in touch with us.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. So the two spirits of the gentlemen were here today.
Yes.
And you feel that they were talking about something?
Some kind of they went away, they flew from here, mm-hmm, and they come back successfully. And they've done a good job. They've done a good job. It seems that they've gone abroad or they've gone a distance, and they've done a good job. But one of them, I know, who comes here in visitation, I feel, out of the two, mm-hmm, quite regularly, he may do certain things if people are around. And I've just asked now my guide Sam about this man, and he's a very, very good, brave man. And he just said, MacPherson is here. MacPherson comes back here often.
Okay.
Are you going, Sam? Yes. He'd come back. That's what the discussion was, Ivy. He'd gone with a number of others, and how successful it was. They went and they bombed, or they went down very, very low to bomb a bridge, and they did two bridges.
Okay.
And turned around, and they blew them successfully, and they came back. And he'd no sooner got back here, apparently, and they had to be rushed down here. And it's MacPherson, Wing Commander MacPherson.
Okay.
He's the one who comes here regularly.
He was stationed here.
Well, I take it he must have been,
okay,
otherwise, you know. It's very, his energy, the residual energy from him, I can't make out the other person he was talking to, but the voice I heard was MacPherson.
Why do you think that they would come and visit the air raid shelter? It just seems an odd place to come and visit.
No, it's not a case, I don't feel that's just the case, Evie. Yes, he'd come back if he was familiar and flown from here, and he knew it so well, and he, no doubt he goes all round, but he does come here, and it's like as if even the residual energy is still containing his conversations.
All right. It is interesting because I know many people that have done experiments here and investigated this particular area,
yes,
they've actually picked up and they've heard the squeaking of leather boots.
Yes.
And footsteps as well in here.
Yeah, without a doubt.
I mean, and I can imagine if you're on your own, I mean, it wouldn't be particularly the pleasant experience, would it?
No, it certainly wouldn't. It is very claustrophobic, like you say, and we've got a little bit of light coming off my meter here, but certainly it is dark, it's claustrophobic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it would be scary if you heard anything, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Do you think it's worth calling out to MacPherson?
I do, yes.
Do you think so?
I do, honestly,
I
do.
What's the matter?
No, it's just the flapping of the...
And also there's lots of dried leaves down there.
There must be a deep reason why MacPherson comes here.
Okay.
There must be.
All right. Do you want to ask out, or shall I ask
you out? You ask out.
Are you sure?
These are lovely souls, it appears, you know, they're good souls. And they like lady folk. For the right reasons, so yes.
As long as he doesn't prod me in the back, I don't care. Right, okay. MacPherson? Is there a spirit of MacPherson here in this air raid shelter? Is there a spirit down here with us now? If there is, please give us a sign. Make a noise. Walk towards us. Try and talk to us. Use our medium, Derek, here. Try and communicate through him. Please come forward. Please come forward now. If there's anybody here in this room with us, please try and talk to us. Is there anybody here in this room with us now? Feel like, do you know what I mean?
Yes,
it's scary,
yeah,
but
yeah,
I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel...
At this moment in time, if there would be a response, I'm sure, not saying that he's not actually around. He may be in another section of this site at this given time, but he does come here. I'm just wondering now, I've just asked Sam, would he have been one of the people, the men, the spirit men I was picking up in where the dancing was going on? And there's a strong probability he was one of them.
Okay.
And maybe he's still over there, but he does come here.
Well, maybe what would be a really good idea is to actually, because I'm just thinking maybe more activity would occur if maybe just one of us stayed here, but stayed behind.
Yes.
That might be quite a good idea. Okay.
Yeah.
David, we're gonna try and choose one of our investigators to stay behind here on their own in the air raid shelter. But for now, we don't feel there's anything much here, so it's back to you in the studio.
All right, lovely. Thanks very much indeed. Well, I'm joined now by Carwin Roberts. He's had a number of experiences in that air raid shelter where they are. Tell me, Carwin, when you were listening to Derek just then...
Yeah.
You said you were very impressed by what he was picking up. Why?
It was exactly a week ago now, this time. Myself and Lee went in there. We took a camera with us and we decided, right, we're going to sit here for a few hours and see what we can get.
Right.
And literally within 10 minutes of being there, we got the feeling that we were being watched strongly. You could feel people walking about. And then after being about in there for about 20 minutes, I positively heard two people talking in the doorway, and I said,
which
to
is
them,
what Derek said tonight. Two men talking.
Yeah, like they were having a conversation about something, and I said to Lee, "Did you hear that?" But he didn't. But I clearly heard it coming from the doorway.
Okay. Well, that's and in terms of there was something else he mentioned or Yvette mentioned about squeaky boots. You've heard that as well.
Yeah. Now again, when you're in there, you'll hear the boots a lot. You'll hear the thumping of the boots, and then you'll hear the squeak, which a lot of people that know a lot about the RAF have said that they were flying boots that they can hear.
Okay, all right, well, let's see what happens tonight as the night unfolds. Let's go back now and rejoin Yvette.
Okay, now, that's you. Okay, well, just something really extraordinary has just happened. While we were talking, we could hear somebody, a male voice outside, and we just carried on because we just thought it was possibly a member of the crew out there. We've just gone out there, nobody said a word, and I don't know if anybody picked it up at home or heard it, but we all heard it in here, but apparently nobody said a word. Also, Sally, just tell us what you've experienced.
Well, I just went out, came back in, and there was a really strong smell of like leather or like shoe polish or something like that. And can you smell it as well?
Yeah, we both smelt it. And I know we've got to go back to the officer's mess because I know something's happening with Brian. Can you hear me in the officer's mess? A name. I think he's saying Jeffrey.
Hide.
It's coming through quite strong. He's...
CO?
I can't see him. I can just hear what he's saying.
Hide. Jeffrey.
Okay. I'm going to come over now and see how Brian is doing. I'm going to leave the air raid shelter and possibly leave one member of the crew here to carry on this vigil on their own. I'm on the way over to see Brian. I'm going to leave now, okay? Okay, that's what I'm going to do. Leave one of you guys here on their own. You choose who it's going to be. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, David.
Lovely. Thank you very much indeed, Yvette. Gosh, that is really, really gripping viewing there in the 1940s room. We'll obviously keep an eye on what's going on there. We'll join you again in just a few minutes' time. See you in a few minutes. Welcome back to Most Haunted Live, this the third night. Now, just before the break, we left Brian Shepherd, who was in the officer's mess, and it appeared that he'd been taken over by a spirit, someone who he was calling Jeffrey. Is this the same Jeffrey that we met last night? Let's go over to the officer's mess now and find out.
different,
okay.
Jeffrey.
Okay, tell me who you're picking up now.
I'm picking up three names gone. Three okay. names, 42. 42 squadron?
42 squadron? Yeah.
42 squadron. Three gone, three. John.
When did Jeffrey die? You said Jeffrey
John,
died.
John, Charles, Jeffrey.
Mm-hmm.
Different Jeffrey.
Okay.
When did he die?
When did Jeffrey die? 40.
Both three people in 42, 43.
Mm-hmm.
Squadron 42.
You said one Jeffrey in the break.
Another Jeffrey here. And 4 years since. Died 4 years?
Yes.
Since.
That would make sense.
Recent.
Yes.
4 years. Did not die in the war.
That's right.
Survived the war. Injuries. Mm. Injuries. Burning face, hands, mended.
Try to pick up on the others. Pick up on some other names. Give me some more names.
John, Charles. Lost. Officer, lost.
There's a coal spot over there.
Lost.
Stand in this coal spot.
Lost?
Why Shirley?
We've lost squadron leader.
Just explain to us, Shirley, where the coal spot was that you felt.
Just round about here.
Yes.
You were dancing around and you felt the cold spot.
Very, very cold.
Right, okay. Yeah, I can feel it now. Yeah. It's there.
Can you feel the cold spot? Yes. Squadron leader, hide.
Okay.
Hide.
Right.
Lost. Gone.
Are they all here
all
now
dead.
In the room? Are they all
dead,
here
yes.
now in the room?
Yes.
They're amongst us now.
Yes.
Okay, there's freezing here.
Jeffrey?
Absolutely freezing, Kieran.
Jeffrey, as before.
It's about 0.1 degree less.
It is.
But it's just 0.1.
Can you
it's
feel
not
it
significant
there,
enough.
Feel it?
There's a definite difference in temperature.
Yeah.
Whether it's freezing or not,
I
don't know. But...
Can I tell you what I'm receiving
yeah.
now?
Mm-hmm.
Very strongly, okay? Absolutely. We've got squadron leader Jeffrey Page here. We have Wing, the other gentleman that was here before. Thank you, sir. Wing Commander Hurst is in attendance as well. Thank you. And also, give me the other, please. Yes. Okay.
You are. Right.
Yes.
Hide.
As well. I'm getting hide.
Okay.
Hide. Good.
Can you see them? Where
hide.
Are they?
Gone.
Yes.
Can you see
Lost.
Them, Brian?
Mm.
Brian.
Yes.
Can you see them?
Yes.
Where are they? Point to them. Show them to me.
They're over here.
Where?
They're over here.
Okay. Can you feel anything, guys?
Yes.
As you're moving around.
Yes. Here. The three. Here.
Three of them there.
Yeah. Three here.
Can you feel anything as you're moving around, guys?
Mm-hmm.
Can you feel something?
Just past the My arms are fine, and every time I jump to that spot, my one arm just starts aching really bad.
Okay, you're feeling burning on your arms.
Yeah.
Derek, are you picking up anything up in this area as well?
Yes, there's conditions here about another person, another spirit man, who actually, in actual fact, his arms and the lower torso badly burned, yet surviving. He got back here, he survived for a period of time. And this was 1943. He went over, he was in the tornado. Was it a tornado?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Yeah. No, sorry, forgive me. This is another, come on. Yes. Okay. Can you give me your name, please? Bless you. Give me your name.
It's so cold, isn't it?
Okay. Yes, this is definitely, this is the man. Yes. Okay. Hurst.
Can you ask them to do something? Can you ask them both of you now,
Jeffrey,
can you ask them to do something, move something, do something to prove that they're here?
Yes.
Okay.
Derek, ask out loud.
Wing Commander, please. Wing Commander Hayes, please, will you now? I know you're very happy. You're seeing everyone joyful and dancing. Do something for us in this atmosphere. Make it obvious to everyone that you are actually here, present with the other officers and gentlemen. Mr. McPherson, I know you're very close here also. Please, can you join force with Mr. Hayes, please? The two wing commands, please, do something in this atmosphere to show everyone that you are in attendance, that you are in visitation. We know you're here. Bless you.
Was there a door banging at the back there?
Yeah, I think so.
The door banged at the back there.
Was it?
Yeah. Do you want to go and check it out?
Yeah.
Oh!
Yes, that was a clutter.
Yeah. What's happened over there?
There's something else.
Bottles.
Yeah.
Thank you. Will you keep doing
it? Over, yeah, it is, over on the back.
It's
yeah.
Mr. McPherson, this, that's done that.
I heard that.
Yes, the bottles,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
The rattle bottles.
Yeah.
This is Wing Commander McPherson that's just done this.
Is it?
Yes.
Okay.
God, it's freezing. I don't know if the thermal imaging camera is picking up any differences in temperature.
There's nobody here, Yvette. Yeah. There's nobody behind.
Well, who banged the door? Because there was a door that banged as well. The bottles did clank, didn't they?
Yeah, definitely. There was no one there,
The door bang is one of the crew behind here, but the rattling of the bottles, there's nobody behind here that...
Okay.
There's another instance.
I'm sorry, but I'm getting something better. I'm getting Jeffrey again.
Come on, guys.
Jeffrey.
He's in attendance.
Four years since. He died 4 years ago.
He didn't go in the wartime.
He didn't go in the war. He was injured. He was mended. Wait. Archie. Thank you, Archie.
What does that mean?
Archie. Surgeon. Guinea pig. Mackindo. Archie Mackindo.
Who helped Jeffrey?
Archie Mackindo saved his life.
Yes, he did.
He saved his life.
Yes.
He put him together.
Ask him to do something. He's a guinea pig.
Yes.
Ask him to do something more for us now. Ask him to come forward. Come and do something for
come
us now.
Come forward. Show us. Show us your presence now. Show us.
Come on, Jeffrey.
It's here.
Tell him to turn the music off. Do something.
Whatever.
Anything.
Guinea pig. It makes sense now.
Okay, we're going to check all this out.
The picture I gave.
Come on.
Can we open the picture later, please?
Yes. Okay.
It makes sense now.
Right. Oh, I see what you're saying. David, please, we've got to go back to the studio. We heard the bottles moving, a door bang. The temperature has dropped in here dramatically. The information that Brian and Derek have come out with, for me, is fascinating.
It certainly is fascinating, Yvette. Thank you very much. Well, let me ask the historians here, Richard Jones and Richard Felix. Let's start, first of all, with you, Richard Jones. Jeffrey, we heard the name Jeffrey again. The names that I want you to pick up on are Hyde, Jeffrey and Hurst. What do you know about those?
We have, he said a squadron leader, and there was a squadron leader of that name, and he was actually shot down. He actually led his squadron on a raid in 1942, on August the 19th. He didn't come back from the raid. There's a lot of argument over how many were actually killed in that raid. The records seem to show that he was the only one killed. He also, Derek also mentioned him before the break. It was a very little whisper. I don't know if many people heard that, but Derek was actually whispering Hyde, just before the break. So that came through. And also, we've got a Broadhurst so far.
Also, what about this name, Archie McKindle? Surgeon
that's,
Archie
that's
McKindle?
That's quite interesting, because that seems to go back to last night when we picked up on Jeffrey P. You might recall that we did state that Jeffrey P. had revolutionary plastic surgery.
And he'd had some sort of burn
He'd burnt his face, and it was at the East Grinstead Hospital, it was actually revolutionary at the time. It was the revolutionary use of skin or plastic surgery to repair burnt faces of airmen, so they did become effectively what he said, the guinea pigs.
So again, these are all very accurate, and you can look up all these names.
Certainly, yeah.
How easy is it for anyone to look up these names?
It's relatively easy if you know where to look.
Okay. Eight. All right, now, Richard Phillips, I want to go back to the beginning. In the air raid shelter, we were talking earlier on about the two male voices, and this thing about, it was good sortie, we flew from here, but two planes, and you think there is some relevance?
Well, it's absolutely fantastic, because the very first sortie that was ever conducted from this base was on the 26th of November 1941, just after the place had been built, and two Spitfires were scrambled from this base to intercept three Junkers Ju-88s, and they shot one of the three down, which in other words was a successful sortie. And I'll be very honest with you, that isn't easy to find out.
Really?
No, it isn't. It took an awful lot of doing, and it's in a very rare book that I happen to have here with me, and I tell you, nobody else has seen it. It's good. But it's fascinating to hear the two of them together, because the more mediums you get, the more... We've got so much information coming out. Richard and I can't actually cope with it. We've got tons of it.
Yes.
Can I just point out something from last night as well? Because in all the excitement last night, one thing that Derek did come up with that went missed, he came up with the South African Air Vice Marshal who sent many men to death. Actually, there was just such a one who sent 26 of his 29 squadrons to RAF Canberra for training prior to the D-Day landings.
Really?
So, and that came up last night, but we lost it in all the excitement.
I know,
there
was so much last night, and it appears there's so much tonight as well.
Yep.
One thing I do want you to look up, could you look up this name McPherson as well? I don't think you've got that just yet. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for the moment. Okay, good. Mr. Louis, what do you make of that then?
Oh, we're certainly getting some impressive information. I'd like to know how rare the books that...
Mr. Felix says rare.
Well, how rare is rare? But definitely it's impressive information.
All right, hang on, Mr. Felix, how rare is rare?
How rare is what? The book?
Yeah.
Oh, extremely rare. It's been out of print for many, many years. I just happen to have a copy with me. Nobody's seen it, I can assure you. And it's not as if it's people's names that we're coming up with. It's just this incident that happened to be... a success at the beginning of when this place was built. It isn't easy to find, I promise you.
Okay, the other thing I do want to pick up on here, Louis, sure. is that we've got Brian and we've got Derek, both of them picking up on similar things.
Sure.
A coincidence?
It may be stretching the point to say coincidence, but a lot of the information we're getting is fairly vague. The names like Jeffrey, that's being repeated over and over again. But as I say, it is impressive that there is this correspondence between the two of them. So if you want me to say I don't know, I don't know.
Okay, from sitting on the fence, which you were at the beginning, two nights ago, where do you sit now?
I'm still on the fence, if I can say that.
Have you moved at all on the fence?
Only if the wind has kind of pushed me in the storm. But
you're still very firmly
I am still
in the middle
of the fence. Yeah, sure. I'm afraid, sorry.
All right, thank you for the moment. Okay, Gillian, what do you have for us?
Thanks very much for that. Now, we'll come back to the webcams a little bit later on, but let's just talk about EVP, which is electronic voice phenomenon. A lot of response to this on our website, livingtv.co.uk/most haunted. So let's listen to a couple that we played two nights ago, the first and second track of EVP. So let's listen to the first one, track one. Hundreds of people reported hearing a voice at the end saying no. Listen to this. So this is the first track, track one. I hope it's going to roll. Maybe it isn't. There's also the second track. A lot of people said it seemed to contain the sound of marching or rifles being loaded. But let's listen to track one again.
Make sound so that we can hear you, please.
Yeah, you just hear... And people at home have got big speakers and so on. You could reckon it's someone saying no there. And then on track two, is this the sound of marching or rifles being loaded? Listen to this. So that's that, and we've got two more tracks tonight, track five and six, and later on we'll play those and we'll tell you what people are saying, because we're getting a big response on those already on the website, so thank you for that. David, over to you.
Thank you very much. It's absolutely fascinating, isn't it, that? Tonight's mysteries deepen. We have to take a short break now, but join us in a few minutes when we'll continue to delve into the unknown. Welcome back to Most Haunted Live on this, the third night. Now, we're at the base for RAF Canberra. I just want to say thank you to someone who's just called in, who works at Clambetta Airfield. Now, this person doesn't want to be named, but says that they want to report several incidences dating back to the mid-90s that are still happening at this airfield. They say that the co-workers at the airfield hear the door to the air traffic control tower open, footsteps run upstairs, but when they go to look, no one is ever there. Do you know more about that? Let us know. Well, over the last few days, we've also been noticing a pattern with this site, because although we were first drawn here by the stories of its war hauntings, what has become increasingly clear is that the activity here is much older than that. And just next to where we are is a place called Shell Island. It's known locally as Mokras. It's literally a stone's throw away. And perched in the middle of the windswept island is a building which is known as the Old Farmhouse, part of which dates back to the Doomsday Book. Now, for reasons that we don't understand, it's seemingly a paranormal hotspot all of its own. And here's its story.
Shell Island is a tidal peninsula. At low tide, it is accessible by a narrow causeway from Llambedda village. It lies in the shadow of the treacherous Rhynog Mountains and south of Harlech's mysterious and ancient castle. Known as Mokras in Welsh, the island and its natural harbour have been home to an abundance of paranormal activity since prehistoric times. The surrounding seas have become the watery grave for seafarers, pirates, smugglers, and in the last century, a strangely large number of distressed aircraft and crew. From its windswept and often deserted beaches, mysterious and eerie lights are seen falling slowly towards the horizon. Ghostly planes are heard dive bombing or passing overhead. The historic and imposing stone-built Old Farmhouse dominates the island and keeps a sinister yet watchful eye over the bay. Inside the farmhouse, with its ancient beams and stone floors, the piano is often heard playing by itself. Up the creaking stairway and along the landing, a melancholy young lady wanders forlornly around the bedroom. And in another room, a terrifying poltergeist threw objects from the top of a wardrobe. It is said that a tremendous, mysterious energy emanates from the island. Could this be responsible for the many unexplained air crashes in the bay and surrounding mountains?
Well, two nights ago before the storm hit, Yvette and the team went out at low tide when the island can be reached by road to investigate that mysterious cottage.
Has anything come to you straight away, Derek?
Well, since we've entered this section here of this building, I'm aware of what's coming from the residual energy. Not so much activity of a spirit person, but I am aware now that there is movement and has been movement through spiritual activity in this atmosphere, in this ether. Mm-hmm. Now, I just feel as if there's a male and a female that are connected together, who belong together. Thank you, Sam. He's confirming that. But there's another male that's got no connection with them, so I've got to take it maybe he's not family. The female and the male, I take it to either they're a brother and sister or a husband and wife. And they are connected. But this other masculine, this other male spirit person that visits, it's like as if he goes way back in time. He goes way back in time. It's separate to these this couple. And I feel as if the man and woman... No, I really feel as if they're connected in maybe the husband and wife.
Could you want to go through into that room there?
Can we?
Yeah?
Yeah, love it, yeah. Maybe see if there's more.
You see?
Yes. Okay. Okay. Oh. It's okay, yeah. It's okay. Now, in here, the energies, it seems that the energies seem to stop and stay a little bit longer. In other words, maybe I feel the, there's one. Okay, who's he? Thank you. Okay. Philip, is it? Come on, Sam, help me with that. Phillips, is that a surname? Phillips. Okay,
It sounded like, is it Sean? Sean? Sounding like, I'm not sure whether that's correct with this, but it sounded like Sean and then Phillips. Sean Phillips.
Sean Phillips, so he's the man on his own.
I feel he's the singular person. His energy comes in here.
Okay.
And it's like as if he walks round and he's looking at the scenery, he's looking at the furniture, and it's like as if he's shown a disapproval.
He doesn't like it.
He doesn't like the change.
When did he live here?
When did he live here? That sounds like 1700 something. 17? Is that 1700?
Did you just hear something?
Yeah.
What did you hear?
They heard the door, like a slight tap, yeah. Slight scratch on this door.
It's wedged in between two stones.
It was ever so slight, but it was mm-hmm. it was like I can't even. Well, Kath, come on in.
And we were standing, I'm just around the corner here, and by the piano it was like a creak kind of, but it was a loud, it wasn't like it would relaxing, do you know what I mean? It was louder than that.
You mean almost, what, like someone's...
Maybe it's stood against it, you know, like...
A leaning?
Yeah.
All right. That's strange.
So it wasn't the sort of sound, you said it's not like wood relaxing, it's not like wood cooling down because it's colder in here.
Yeah, how Derek's just leant against that chair then.
Yes, I have.
It was like that kind of,
yeah,
you know, like...
It
was louder.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Right. I reckon we should go upstairs.
Yes, yeah.
Come on, let's go.
You know, at some given time there was, no doubt there's a lot of love still here in the area, in the atmosphere, but there's been a lot of love displayed here by, no doubt, previous occupiers. And there's one particular couple whose energies I don't feel have left very long. They may have even left the spirit people, man and woman, and then out of this place, I'm explaining myself, I don't want to get mixed up here, they've lived here, dwelt here, maybe owned something in that fashion, and in older life they've had to move, or in some way, but just of recent, maybe in recent times, I've got an energy that's very close by now, he's making my hearing as if I'm deaf, here in my right ear, hard of hearing, and maybe this is the man and the woman, the husband and wife, and they firmly believe this is why they're in visitation, since they've left the spirit body. They are truly in the world of spirit, they come in visitation, and they're a lovely couple.
Shall I ask out, or do you want to ask out?
Yes, go on, Evie, you ask and see if we can get a reaction.
Are there any spirits here in this room with us?
We're
in this house. Are there any spirit people here in this room with us now, or any spirits in this house that can hear my voice? If you can hear my voice, please give us a sign. Please give us a sign. Come forward. Either knock on something, rap on something, move something, just to let us know that you can hear my voice clearly. Please come forward. We don't mean you any harm at all. Did you hear that?
Yeah. Yeah. So just by that.
There's a tiny little... What is there? Please, is there anybody here in this house that can hear my voice? Any spirit people that would like to come forward? If there is, please give us a sign. What do you reckon that noise was there? Did you hear it, Kieran?
Mm. Yeah, my first impression was that it might be some clock or something ticking over there, but it wasn't. There is a fireplace down here, so it would be good to know if that was on or there was any fire going earlier on in the day, because it could have been.
Okay. All is quiet. We've heard a couple of noises. I mean, for me, I don't know about you, Kieran, but for me the most interesting bit has to be when we were downstairs in what is actually called the chapel room part of the house, and
right.
I heard something almost scratching on the door, and then Kath heard something as if leaning near the piano.
Yeah.
That to me is
is interesting.
Yeah, and the entire time we've been in the house, I've had an MP3 recorder and an MP4 visual recorder set up on the piano because of previous eyewitness reports. So we can listen back to that and see if we've got that sound on there.
Okay, well, let's make our way out then. Mm-hmm.
Well, as I said, that was a couple of nights ago before that terrible storm hit. Historians, I want to pick up on this name that Derek picked up here. Sean Phillips. Sean Phillips.
Absolutely correct. Yeah, both names right. Sean Phillips was a famous Welsh bard, and he actually lived in that farmhouse, and he drowned in 1620. He was rowing himself back across the causeway, and for some reason, I presume, fell out of the boat and drowned, and he's buried in a nearby church. It's fascinating. He's marvellous, the bloke is.
Thank you very much indeed, Richard Phillips. Anything to add?
I can just add that he was the author of Ode to a Seagull.
You are such a clever man, aren't you? Thank you very much, gentlemen, for the moment. Now, one thing I do want to remind you of. Now, do you remember last night, we broke the seal on our 1940s room experiment. You may remember, actually, Andy cutting that padlock off. Now, that room had always been the centre of a sort of bewildering range of poltergeist activity. So what we did, Louis and Kieran set up a number of active experiments on our first night, and then we sealed the room. The question is, what did they find? Well, chaps, what did you find?
We found a few things. We've got Polaroids here.
Yeah.
We found some auditory phenomena that I think we're both we are fascinated by.
You mean, in real speak, you heard something?
We heard something.
Right.
Yeah, or at least the equipment that we had in there heard something.
Okay. Shall we have a listen to what you picked up?
Sure.
All right, let's hear it now. Okay, we're not looking at the beeping there or hearing the beeping.
No.
Just describe what you think you heard.
It's very, very faint, but it's footsteps. Footsteps, maybe five or six, then a pause, and then some more footsteps, and that's what it sounds
okay,
like.
Okay, listen very, very carefully. We'll play that again. Let's hear it now. I have to say, I definitely heard something there that sounded like footsteps. Like Louis, footsteps. What do you make of that?
Well, I mean, I don't necessarily want to call it footsteps.
Okay.
I mean,
did you hear something?
An anomalous sound. I mean,
you hear something?
There's definitely an anomalous sound on the tapes. What we can do?
So you heard something?
Yes.
Right. Thank you.
I'll admit to that.
Right.
But what we can do with that, David, is we can, since we had two recordings in the room, is we can compare those recordings and perhaps get some idea of maybe where the sound was in the room. And maybe get some other idea about what qualities were causing the sound.
Yeah, so focus. If it is paranormal, then we could maybe get spatial representation of exactly where the focus of the spirit might be, if it is a spirit.
Okay. Now, what do you make of that, David Wells?
Well, I think it might have convinced Louis a little less, probably, if it'd been Lionel Blair that was making those footsteps.
Right.
But I think the footsteps, and to me, the fascinating thing is there is a carpet in that room. And it
yes,
sounds,
good point. Very yeah, good point.
And it sounds to me like they're on a wooden floor, which in the time I would imagine there were wooden floors.
Can I just add to that? Because further to that, as soon as I heard footsteps, my instant sceptical reaction was it could be security guards outside walking around, and we picked up those sounds. I spoke to the head of security. He informed me who the security guards would have been walking around. And earlier on today, I actually went round the building, got them to walk around, recorded the sound of the footsteps from inside the building. You cannot hear them walking around. They've got quite soft shoes anyway, these security guards, but you cannot hear their footsteps, so it's not from outside.
Now, I know earlier on today when we were here, I caught you listening to that MP3 player, didn't I? Listening and listening and listening. So, as an open-minded skeptic, how do you view that particular evidence?
I think it's very convincing evidence, very convincing, because it was a locked-off room. I set it up, Louis supervised it, and I actually sealed it myself. Nobody got in. We've got two pieces of equipment.
Okay, very quickly, photographs showed anything?
Nothing really.
Okay.
We've got a couple of photographs. The torch goes out.
And you took those Polaroids every hour, so there's no change there?
No change.
All right, and one other thing, the coins. Did the coins move?
The coins did move very, very slightly.
So the coins moved?
Yeah, I'm not saying it's paranormal. They did move very slightly. We've discussed what it could possibly be, but we're not...
Empty room.
In an empty... Well, it
well there is water damage, and, you know, the storm was raging, so and we did have water damage in the room, so I don't think it's too far to say that the wind could have been blowing rather hard that night, so...
Mm. So, footsteps, coins moving, what's going on? Find out after this break.